I think one of the biggest complaints I hear and get is like, if I powerlift, will I get bulky? Or will I get look too strong? Or will I look a certain way?
Yeah.
I think Instagram, unfortunately, has put us in a position where we see those types of physiques where people shy away from heavy compound lifts. But for me, like, I was able to lose so much weight. I felt like I was able to get so much stronger through a powerlifting program. And I chose to compete. The diamonds are symbolic of all the pressure they put on me until I shined. My life is symbiotic with the culture. I could never, ever lose the vibe. Make sure they rolling one up for me, because it's been a long ride. We doing this one for Money T. Keep his name alive.
Jump in. All right, Kishan Patel, welcome to the Healthy Indian Podcast. Honestly, this is the first Indian in-person podcast, so glad to have you on. You know, a little bit about you. You know, you're a powerlifter, you're a physical therapist. A couple things I want to learn about you today is describe yourself in a few words and what you do, and maybe why I can help our audience. Let's take it from there, I guess.
For sure. I would say being a PT, being a powerlifter, my main thrust is movement specialty. So whatever type of movement you're trying to perform, how can I make it better? And that's really what it is. I'm driven by movement and just trying to get better each and every day.
Awesome. Awesome. So I guess like when it comes to movement, how do you kind of assess patient care, just talk a little bit about your journey of how you found physical therapy.
Yeah.
Let's start there. I think that's a really cool take about how you found your niche, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah. I was a personal trainer like 10-ish years ago working at 24 Hour Fitness. I had no idea what I was doing, I'll be honest. I was seeing clients. Honestly, I was just trying to sell them as the biggest package that I could, make the most commission. But then over time, I started to realize that what I was actually doing with them was unfair. It was unjust to what the whole overall process was. And so I realized I needed to develop a knowledge base to actually get them to where they needed to be. Looking at the time, I needed some stability. I needed something where I felt like I could actually learn that way. And so that's what kind of drove me into PT. Eventually, I started shadowing at clinics and eventually applying to schools. And that's kind of where I got to be. But honestly, I really love what I do. Just to see patients get better and better each day, their drive, their motivation, it's honestly inspiring to me too.
Definitely. And, it goes hand in hand with what you do on the side,
for sure,
which is powerlifting. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I feel like with bodybuilding all and powerlifting, a lot of injuries happen. Mm-hmm. How do you also take care of yourself? Because I mean, you're always taking care of patients,
yeah.
But how do you also take care of yourself on a day to day? Take care of your body, stretching, all that stuff's very important for you to also do your job and help people with preventive care and stuff mm-hmm. like that. So,
yeah, I think what it is that being very intentional with mobility and stretching. I think we just throw around stretching, we throw around mobility as a word, but to each individual, and I think this is why it's so important that, you know, there's YouTube videos, there's all a lot of great content out there for each individual, but each individual's biomechanics, yours, mine's, anyone's in the gym, are very, very different. Why do you squat a certain way? Why do I squat a certain way?
Right.
Why do you deadlift a certain way? Why do I deadlift a certain way? So based on those biomechanics, what mobility and movement preparation routines do I need to make sure not only am I the most effective, but what's keeping me the most safe? And I would say on top of that is you're going to have cycles of injury with any sport, no matter what. There's going to be inflammation.
Absolutely.
There's going to be things that go on with all the different joints. So knowing at that moment of time when to hold back, when to do certain preventative movements, when to do certain mobility routines. I think that's been so clutch for me as a physical therapist, because when I feel something on a descent of a squat, I know, all right, maybe my lumbar extensors are having an issue here. Let's drive core and glute activation. Or I'll hold off on a set knowing that maybe I'll just take an L today for a better tomorrow. So I think that has just helped me so much because it's just kept me safe. With powerlifting, longevity is the game. You can push yourself that first year, push through injuries,
absolutely,
but you're not going to make it for 10 years. So really, it's all about staying in the game long enough. Even if it means you only put up 5 pounds more in 2 months. But if you're in the game, staying in the long haul, you'll see success in that way.
Yeah, I was watching a powerlifting video yesterday. I was looking at
top
powerlifting. And I forgot the guy's name, but basically, he was powerlifting. And it was like you said, it was a 5 or 10 pound difference.
Yeah.
But he was judging himself really hard on how it's like another obstacle in his place.
Yeah.
And when he was trying to push through, he's just like, you know, kind of going through like a mental thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, in reality, it's just 10 more pounds. But 10 more pounds at such a high level is such a big deal,
yeah,
that you don't realize like how big, like, you know, how big it is, right?
Mm-hmm.
From the outside perspective, it's like, oh, this guy can lift 1,000 pounds. But 1,010 is like a huge level.
Game changer, yeah.
So, you know, tell me a little bit about your journey, because you did already, what, 1, 2 comps?
3 comps, actually.
3 comps.
3 comps as of 2 weeks ago, yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay, so... tell me a little bit about that. Like,
yeah,
how was the experience for you? from your first comp to now, yeah. What did you learn?
I think it was definitely nerve-wracking for each comp. And I think what you said is, like, you usually tend to put up the numbers in the gym into the powerlifting meet. So powerlifting meets, how they usually work is you have 3 squat attempts, 3 bench attempts, 3 deadlift attempts, right? So my coach is usually the one who picks each attempt for me. So let's say I'm putting up 350 for my first squat. He'll see how I moved, 370, and then 400, let's say. But the real, like, nerve-wracking or, you know, part that requires the most mental intensity is right before the moment you hit the bar, because you're unsure whether you're going to hit it or not, because any given day, you're going to feel very, very differently.
Right.
And so it's like you said, even 10 pounds on the bar feels considerably heavier than 20 pounds when you're first starting out. What I've always felt is that, like, once I hit, like, the 300, 400 squat pound, everything just feels heavy. There's not, like, even in 2 or 3 years from now, 400 pounds is still going to feel heavy as it does now. So I think that's really one thing I've realized, is that no matter how the movement feels, you just got to push through it and then feel like you can get better each and every time you do it. In terms of competitions, though, my first one was really just a throwaway. I was just, like, trying to get used to the rules. There's command cues you don't want to mess up. The second one, I was pushing for a little bit more. Let's see if I can medal, if I can place. And then this third one was actually kind of a drawback, because I didn't put up my best performance, but I'm happy that it happened on my third local one, so that at least now I know what type of mistakes I usually make because the first two won so well, and then how to kind of push forward from there.
I think the fact that you even attempted a competition that most people would not even, can't even train for, yeah, is pretty amazing, because it's hard to stay, you know, also with the diet, right? That's a whole different side the whole equilibrium, right? And at the end of the day, like, it's not just the numbers and the results, but it's also like what you do on day to day. I remember we were chilling at Taco Bell and everyone was just like eating Taco Bell, and you were like, you know what, I'm just gonna have this diet, you know, blah blah zero, and you're like, the cravings are, I remember you saying that too in front of everyone, and I was like, how is he able to like say no? But like, you know, the fact that you were competing in the few months kept you motivated.
For sure. I think the fact that we spent too much time at Taco Bell is that's the number one issue we gotta figure out first. I think that's the great thing about powerlifting, is that when you cater yourself to a goal where it's like, I have this comp date in 6 months, where it may be, the discipline when you have a set date and drive, I think, is so, so amazing. One of the coaches at my gym, he's the owner as well. What he does is, no matter who his clients are, he always pushes them to compete. Not because, no matter how old they are, he's had clients that compete at 40, 50, 50 plus. Not more so because they're doing great, they'll put up great numbers, but if you have a set date in mind, your consistency and discipline just stay that much stronger. And that's why, honestly, I recommend powerlifting to anyone. I think one of the biggest complaints I hear and get is like, if I powerlift, will I get bulky? Or will I look too strong? Or will I look a certain way?
Yeah.
I think Instagram, unfortunately, has put us in a position where we see those types of physiques where people shy away from heavy compound lifts. But for me, like, I was able to lose so much weight. I felt like I was able to get so much stronger through a powerlifting program. And I chose to compete, but that doesn't mean necessarily everyone has to. And competitions are all about just putting the best version of yourself out there. You go in there, have a good time. The community is amazing. Everyone's supportive. And as a sport, it's you against you. Obviously, there's other people in your weight class. You're trying to medal, whatever it may be. But at the local, even sometimes the state, at the end of the day, it's, I just want to do the best version of myself. I want to take all the hard work I put in for 6 months training and just show it on the platform. Because if you squat 420 in a competition and you get 3 green lights, no one can take that away from you. You attempted it, you performed it in front of judges,
exactly.
You own that weight. Versus in the gym, yeah, you may have attempted it, but was the depth there, was the command cue there, but no one can take that away from you because it was in front of judges and it was all green lights.
And if I'm correct, can you define, so the people know, what is a green light? And two, I do see the videos where there's like 3-4 people around you and they're like going down. What is that? What are they doing? Yeah. Like, you know, that's not normal at the gym, right?
Yeah.
Always a dude behind you.
Yeah.
So just to like, you know, add to the audience.
For sure. Powerlifting, usually there's a, it's usually white light. I said green, but I've seen green and white depending on the type of competition. Yeah. But white light pretty much means that you hit all the boxes, because there's 3 judges usually. There's a front and a side judge. So each judge is usually viewing a certain thing. So for squat, they're looking at depth. There's certain commands for a squat. So when you get up after your squat, there's a rack command. So then with that rack command, only then can you then rack the weights back in.
Oh, okay.
They check for depth. They check for full stillness. They look for lockout at the knees. So there's all these like technical rules for each of the lifts. So for bench, they have their technical rules for deadlifts. And so if you want to lift to count, you need to get 3 white lights. And so if you unfortunately don't get 3 white lights for any one lifts, let's say you miss 3 squats in a row, technically you're disqualified from the competition. So that's why a lot of coaches, what they'll do is their first attempt is like, easy, like cakewalk, just so that you get the numbers on the board and then you can push and go from there. But it also changes your strategy. At my last competition, unfortunately, my second one, I got called for depth for my squat attempt, Therefore, for my third, I was like, I can push it very aggressively, but let's say I got a red light for my third attempt, then my first attempt would have been the only one that counted towards my total. Therefore, what I had to do was take it a little bit easier just so I can get a PR, but not as intense. I wish I could have pushed a little bit more, but it's something now I can learn from and then go from there.
Awesome. Awesome, man. No, that's awesome. And like, maybe just to like add, you know, I feel like with me, I struggled a lot with just kind of like kind of lifting at the gym.
Yeah.
And, you know, you recommended me the Candido workout. Yeah. It really did help me, right?
For sure.
And I saw numbers that I'd never seen before. Right. I never would ever guess like I could lift that much weight.
Yeah.
So I definitely did see the benefit. As far as like a mental challenge or like a mental health challenge, I definitely always struggled growing up.
Yeah.
As kind of looking in the mirror and seeing like the best version of myself. Yeah. So like, do you also experience that kind of thing? Because you're at such a high level now, probably from like years ago. Or to the normal man.
Comparatively
to the average Joe, I guess. but like, you know, you're at this competitive level. Mm. Do powerlifters and, you know, people that are so active as yourself, do you kind of go through that kind of like maybe body dysmorphia, maybe a mental health crisis sometimes when it comes to like just not hitting your numbers, having a whole horrible diet week?
Yeah.
You know, does that ever happen?
Absolutely. And I will say like, I know I've been powerlifting for a while, but I'm still like very average, above average, still trying to work through my thing. So biggest thing is I've improved from day one. But in terms of the mental health challenge, I think body dysmorphia is, I think, very, very real. But I think powerlifting, and it could like go in the same, you know, umbrella of it, is very much so strength dysmorphia. Because when you see, again, same thing with Instagram, you see the physiques and models. But then for us, like, you know, following a bunch of powerlifters, you see a lot of where there's guys who are younger than you, who might be on steroids, who have been doing it for longer, at the same weight class, putting up so much heavier numbers where it's like, damn, I'm 28 now, but there might be a guy who's 21 putting up crazier numbers.
Oh,
and so the strength dysmorphia and the mental health challenge, I think, is very, very real. I'll say I've experienced it through so many times. I think the two things that really helped me was, one, keeping my old videos, because when I see where I've started to from where I'm at now, I think that was the big key. And secondly, honestly, once I started coaching myself, coaching powerlifting, just having like my client watching her go through her process, it just kind of always reminded me that all of us are kind of going through that struggle at the same time. So the community aspect, everyone at the gym is going through the same thing too. So having those right people around you, I think, is so important.
And going back to your client as well, learning as somebody that's in training to learning to showing someone else how to do the training.
Absolutely.
You learn so much from that. And I think, you know, to the viewers, Kishan is a certified personal trainer. So you can also train you if you're looking for some kind of training. Okay. But the thing is, like, I think you learn probably a lot too, because then you see like a lot of parts of you going into that and you're like, wait, this is what I could have done better. Yeah. This is how I can help her.
Yeah.
This is exactly what I went through.
Right, right.
What is she saying is exactly what I'm saying about, you know, food or something, or just struggling with some kind of, you know, depth when it comes to squat depth for me is still like,
it's tough, man. Yeah.
It's tough. And that's mainly because of the weight, you know, it's mainly because of the weight. And it's, you know, they say like, it's, you got to use your core and your glutes and stuff. But then they like, I feel like sometimes the weight also has like a impact if it's like heavy enough, you know?
Yeah. I would say that for sure. Like, and also just the cueing, like you said, is like, am I breathing the right way? Am my glutes activated the right way? Is my core activated? There's so much like mental that goes on within the context of the squat too, especially as you put heavier numbers, because God forbid you get hurt, the more heavier weight you put on your back, you need to be more locked in with your cueing. So I think that's absolutely very true.
Awesome. Awesome. And is there any mind shift change you went through from your competitions? Because to get to the next level, it's always like a new level, I guess. Yeah. Because there's no way you did the same thing from day one, right?
Yeah.
Definitely like so much more you changed up. Mm. So do you also kind of embark that on your clients as well? Like maybe giving them different kinds of methods of, you know, strategies to get to their next like PR or level?
Yeah, for sure. And I think that just goes for the general population in hand. It's sometimes like there's two things we see with, or a couple things we actually see with programming that tends to be an issue. One, if you stay on the program for too long, you get way too comfortable with it. If you're not making yourself uncomfortable with your movements, odds are the stimulus that your body is going through isn't going to be good enough to make any sort of hypertrophy if you're trying to lose weight, no matter what it is. I think that is going to be something to be keep an eye on. Or they'll start a program, but they'll quit it too early. So it's kind of like you see both sides of the issue, where you have to make sure that everything in the program is intentional for you and having that established goal. Because technically, you could take a powerlifting program and lose weight on it. You could take a powerlifting program just to look aesthetically better. You could take a powerlifting program and get better at powerlifting. So all those things can still happen, but then the nutrition and all those other things is key. So like, for example, my client, she was struggling a lot with bench. So one of the things I had to make is that her top squat day and her top bench day, where I have her test out a single, were on the same day. So I was thinking, is fatigue potentially an issue? So I split those up, and then after 2 weeks, she was able to hit a new PR. So that's something else to consider. And then how are her warm-ups? What is her mobility routine looking like? What is her stress level, sleep level? Is she works as a teacher right now, so there's certain times of the year. Monitored all those things. If you need to know the stress, the nutrition, the adherence, even how motivated she is. There's certain days where, me included, she, for her probably included, not as much. She's definitely way more motivated than I am. But yeah. For her, like, are there certain days where she's having good or bad days? So monitoring all those things is so, so important. AP time is very busy for her.
What is AP time?
Advanced placement for high school.
Okay.
She's a high school teacher, I'm sorry. So that time is a very, very busy time for her. So I understand maybe her time commitment or even stress levels might be higher. So looking at all those factors is so important because the timing of those lifts are key. So I think if you're doing your own individualized program, I think you have to take a look at all this because we miss the basics. Sleep. Like getting 8 hours of sleep? Are we stress-free? Is our nutrition okay? You know, those basics have to be hit. We too often try to look as, what supplements can I take? Should I do creatine loading or creatine just basics? Should I take a certain pre-workout? But if we don't hit the basics, then I think that has to be fundamentally established before we look at all these other things.
And I'm just trying to think from my perspective. Now, like, Gerba season's coming up.
Yeah.
And realistically, all these events that we're going to, you're going to a wedding tomorrow. I'm going to a wedding.
Right.
How do you kind of balance out like a healthy diet with a social event?
I think...
Because you said all this amazing stuff.
Yeah.
But to put it all in one thing. And like you said, she's an AP teacher, your client as well.
Yeah.
And she's focusing on AP exams, but after she wants to just chill, go out and socialize. And maybe there's a birthday or something, right? How do you kind of break that medium?
Yeah.
You know? And it is sacrifice. I've seen you do it. I've done it myself. Yeah,
absolutely.
But like, I guess, how do you stay consistent with those sacrifices? So you tell yourself that little voice in your head, like, you know, I got to keep going because this is like where I want to be and not deter from my goals and also hinder my progress.
Yeah.
With lifting, mobility, all that stuff.
So I think that there's like two aspects.
Of course.
And then I think I was saying two aspects, right? But it's one of the two aspects.
It's all good. Authentic content, right? It's all good, bro.
Where the planning is key. So I have to know in the entire month what weddings I'm going to, what birthdays I'm going to. If I can establish those things to prep for the meals, to prep for the consistency, it becomes a lot easier. Because you're being thrown into things, you're more likely to fail. That's definitely number one. The two in the mental side of it, and this is something I struggled with because when I initially did powerlifting program, it was more so to lose weight. So I remember I was like 215, 220 at the time. This is while I was in PT school, super uber stressed out, trying to go through, like just going through it. My grades weren't great. I wasn't feeling great about myself, self-confidence at its all-time low.
Oh, man.
So for me, it was like, I wanted to consistently establish five things in my life. I wanted to make sure I did every single day without fail, or to some degree every single day, where it was cold showers, good nutrition, adherence to powerlifting program, meditation, and reading. So the way it worked for me in terms of discipline, where it's, if you think about your entire day, there's 1,000 decisions you make. If you, on 95% of those decisions, you're able to make those decisions and they're catered to that goal. Therefore, you are disciplined, right? So let's say you come up to me and I'm dieting and you ask me for a cookie. I say no because I'm competing and I can't eat that cookie. Therefore, that's one decision I made. And there's also long-term decisions where if I choose to study now, I won't be stressed out next week. Therefore, my anxiety level at the gym is lower. Therefore, I'm going to be able to train harder. So taking a look at all those decisions is so, so key. Now the question becomes is how do you get rid of that little voice in the head? And honestly, for me at that time, and I don't know if this was healthy or unhealthy, that's still something I'm considering too, was negative energy really, really drove me in the sense where I did not feel good about myself and I did not ever want to feel that way again. So every time those decisions were there, it's kind of, I think David Goggins, he talks about it, where it's like, play that low light reel in your head, like all those bad times you've had and how you want to change that aspect of your life. Therefore, playing those things in my head or just even having that feeling when that decision is being made was like, no, I can't do this because I don't want to feel like this again. Therefore, that discipline kind of carried me and pushed me through to do all those things. And also, I think having certain like mediums to give yourself a break is good.
Yeah.
For example, I had those five things where, let's say I was feeling craving, you know, pizza, whatever. For whatever reason, I love pizza at the time. What I would do is instead of breaking on that, because that's a very, you know, very important thing in terms of my goal for powerlifting, I would just take a hot shower, which is much more, you know, enjoyable to me than taking a cold shower. But then my brain thinks it was able to give in on something one day, so then therefore the craving of pizza stopped. So it's kind of like I was tricking my mind in a sense where I was taking something that's low intensity, not too crazy, because switching from one day cold shower to hot shower isn't going to do anything, you know, monumental to my training program. But at least it'll take away that other craving that's there. So I was able to keep myself to like a checks and balance system. And I think that was very effective for me. I was able to go from 220 to, I think, 165 in the span of like a year. And then just having my classmates around was amazing because they just provided so much support.
You think a positive friend circle and a positive people that support your habits, your rituals, your ability to kind of push yourself is a very important thing? Because I feel like peer pressure is like really big.
Yeah.
And I'm saying like if you're not at the right friend group, it can be a little toxic,
right?
But if you're with a friend group that has been understanding, very understanding, then it helps you become a better person.
Yeah.
Right? Because like you said, bad habits, you know, and it's already hard as it is. Alone, right?
Yeah.
Alone and like, you know, you're taking a hot shower. That's like a random day on a Tuesday,
sure,
right?
Sure.
But then when you're with a friend group and then now there's all these like, you know, drinking, you know, eating a lot of paneer, naan, like fatty foods, you know, like rasmalai, you know, all the whole nine yards.
Yeah.
It's hard to like say no to every single time, right?
Yeah.
Until, you know, you develop like some kind of mindset that just, and it's your friends actually kind of being supportive. I think that helps.
Of course.
Right?
I would add Bean Down a Shock to that list too, but
Facts. Bean Down a Shock.
But yeah, like having those people there, especially like when I was down there in Florida for PT school, like going through it all with that, they were just there for me. Like they didn't know what I was going through mentally. They didn't know like the struggles I was feeling and going through. But that support level, just to have them there consistently, was just so amazing. They didn't know to the inner depths of what I was feeling, like the struggles I was going through. But I come home from class, we just sit around and talk. And one of my roommates at the time, he was big into training. He'd always ask me, how did my lift go? Show me a video. And he would always just be there constantly motivating me. And at that time, I wasn't lifting anything crazy. I was like, for my level, for what I should have been, I was just getting getting better each and every day, but very slowly. But he was always constantly motivating me, and having like a Facebook group, WhatsApp group, having a text group, just sending your videos, I think that's key. Something like Strava, but for weightlifting or for like would be amazing. But just do it with two or three people that you love. Have each person send their videos, send the good moments and the bad moments too. I saw this one Instagram account I really loved is in his videos, what he posts is not the good times, but every time he's failed the lift. So there's just pretty much a whole sequence of videos. And to me, it's like, it just shows complete security in who he is because he knows to get to where he had to be.
It's a show.
He had to show all his failures too. And I think that's so amazing.
Yeah.
And I think that's where social media can just be so beneficial, where you don't have to feel the insecurity aspect of it, but you can use that to just build more confidence.
I feel like I have respect for people like that because you don't see that often.
No.
And two is like to show like your losses is a, like in the way people start respecting you more.
Yeah.
You know, so I have something similar, but it's with trading. This guy I follow, and he shows his like losses all the time.
Right.
But I don't like when it comes to trading, all these traders and stuff, when it comes to stocks or whatever, they're very like, oh, I made XXX, the 2X, 3X, 5X. But again, like showing that loss factor is very like reputable because you're like, oh, he's human too. He's not like, it's not like every day he's just going to always have a win, you know?
So. And I think that transparency is so key because when you see someone who's transparent about everything they do, you'll just trust them more. And then that just becomes maybe a mentor or role model that you can look up to for your training if you're just starting out.
Absolutely. And you feel like he's not more of a commercial.
Yeah. He's not trying to sell you something.
He's not trying to sell you something. He's just trying to connect with you. And based on that connection, you're either rocking with him or not, you know? And
for sure.
And the followers don't mean shit. Mm-hmm. So it feels very authentic. Yeah. So
I think one thing I love to see and just like, you obviously get motivation for people who made it, who are great. But when you see someone who's like the first time in the gym or first time running, like you can tell like there's with body language or someone's anxious, you know, someone's like not moving well. But to see someone put themselves, even though that they're having anxiety in the first week of gym just because they don't want to get better, I think that sometimes motivates and inspires me more than even some of the great lifters because what they're going through at that time, you've also gone through it, but you know that difficulty. So when you see
I
think that's also just so motivational at any level. When you see that, I think that's just so amazing.
I think that's what for me, like if I see people at the gym and that are in or out of shape, I would never judge them because then everyone has their own battle.
Exactly.
And you know that like big or small kid tomorrow is going to be the next big thing.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? He may start out a little like slow, but then tomorrow he could be the next big thing and he can, you know, run miles around you.
Yeah.
In whatever he's good at, right?
Right.
So sometimes it's just kind of like seeing like the positive side of things
and definitely.
Stuff too.
Most definitely.
So, you know, but I have a rapid fire round for you. I never thought. I wanted to surprise you with that because I do that with all my guests.
Amazing.
Yeah. So 1 second. I'm trying to find it here somewhere. All right. All right, I have a couple rapid fire rounds. It's fitness related.
Oh, thank goodness.
So you're good. Don't worry. Yeah. Squat, bench, or deadlift?
Squats, without question.
Why squats?
That was my weakest lift, and now it's probably my strongest lift.
You mean like your weakest like exercise or strong?
It was I hated it the most. Now I love it the most. That's because of the biggest transformation. That's why squats, without question.
That's sick. And it's your favorite now, I guess?
My favorite now, without.
Wow.
Definitely.
Okay, sick. Squats are fun once you get to like a pretty high level. Yeah. In CrossFit, when I started with like my glutes and like I was at a very lean phase and I was lifting more than I thought I would. Like
the feeling is amazing.
Yeah.
So great. Yeah.
I feel like $1,000,000. A go-to pre-workout snack.
Snack or drink?
Snack.
That's a great question. I like that. I mean, I don't really drink a snack before. Ghost energy drink. That counts. Ghost. And then if I had a snack, I like Uncrustables. I don't know why, but I just really love Uncrustables. So
those are really good. So they're like I think old school, right?
They're pretty old school. I mean, I just like.
We had them like, junk. I think like what? Like lunch? Or like when we were younger?
When we're not much.
Yeah, I remember you said. You still have?
I went to Wawa once and they ran out, so literally the manager went to the back, so everyone turned and looked at me, is like, why is this grown ass man buying Uncrustables? And it was just so funny. But yeah, I had like 10 or 15 at home for pre-lifts.
That's pretty good. It's like your secret, like, you know, morning workout, night workout.
Night workout. It just seems to be, I have more energy and I'm more of a night person for sure.
Really?
Yeah, I just.
During when we were, you know, going for exams, you used to do morning stuff. And then you used to nap.
I used to nap, but
I'll call you out on that one.
That's true, but I love night workouts just because it's usually more calmer at the gym.
Okay.
And the outdoor gyms in Miami I used to train at, when you did it at night with the weather there, it just seemed like perfect. So I love night workouts.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, I mean, I see what you're saying. Like the climate and stuff like that does impact.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Because, when I went to California, night was amazing. There's like a little bit more. Most awkward moment at the gym. Geez.
This was like my fourth week when I started at this new gym here. There's a really cute girl next to me. I made the mistake of having like bean burrito. So I put a heavy squat up and I ripped a little bit of ass. She had headphones on, so I don't know if she heard me. But she turned and looked this way and I was so embarrassed. I went to the bathroom for like 10 minutes, waited for her to leave, and then I went back to squat. But that was definitely the most embarrassing. I was this close to switching gyms, but like, all right, hopefully I'll figure it out.
From Blink to LA Fitness?
Then I went from LA Fitness to War Room, crazy.
That's a crazy story. Yeah, letting it rip is like insane. And then probably Taco Bell in your hand, right?
I should not have done that. That's bad mistake.
Yeah, I think one time I went to the gym really early in the morning and I was talking to somebody and I realized my breath wasn't the best. And I said hi to them real quick. And then I came back and I'm like, holy shit, it's like 6 in the morning. I should have probably, you know, got up and brushed my teeth. But it was like, you know, this is a very natural reaction. Yeah. And then came back and then, you know, obviously
just happened.
Yeah. You know, I thought I'd throw myself on.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
If you could train with any athlete, who would it be?
Oh, wow. It'd actually be one of my friends. I've never trained with him. His name is Akash Modi. He was an alternate for the USA Olympic team. So I would always wanted to see his strength training routine. He's actually one of my role models. I've talked to him a couple times. Like while he was training and stuff, like he's pretty incredible.
And do you is this something like you still keep in touch with him or whatever?
I text him every now and then. I think it's actually funny. I remember this one time we were in a camp and like me and him just knew each other from before. And so I remember I was going to my room to go grab something. And as I was going up the stairs, I see this dude. Everyone's hanging out outside having a good time. I'm seeing this dude going up and down the stairs 4 times. And I'm like, dude, you know, we're like bawling, we're like playing, we're having like food, we're like all just chilling outside. Like, it's a camp, right? So we're having a good time. And he's like, no, I'm training. And I'm like, what do you mean you're training? He's like, no, I gotta do this for another like hour. I'm still training. I'm just going up, I'm grabbing my stuff. I go down and I looked at this guy and I was like, this is the craziest like guy I've met in my life. Like, why is he doing this? This is when I was in high school. Now looking back, I'm like, dang. The discipline he had and like the intensity he had, it was like, he was like incredible. I always think about that story when I'm like thinking about my training routine. I was like, no matter where he was, what moment he was, his training never stopped.
He didn't allow his environment to
kind of not allow his environment impact to change, him. Which is amazing. Yeah.
Yeah. No, that's his discipline for sure. And that's another great quality that, you know, I feel like I would look up to as well, because it's just like, okay, he's not letting anything stop him.
Yeah. Yeah.
I always watch those videos in India too, like those people like that don't, I guess, like me. They're living in a village, but they wake up and they start doing push-ups with the dog, taking a boulder and like going back and forth with like a freaking rock boulder, and they're ripped out of their minds. Of and you're like, what the hell?
It just goes to show that like, no matter what, if you want it bad enough, you can get it.
The funny thing is they say the six pack is the hardest thing to get, but I don't believe that, because I think it's at the end of the day, I think it's discipline, right?
Yeah.
It's a showcase of discipline.
Yeah.
And at the end of the day, it's like, Not six pack, but whatever, whatever you want. Lean physique, yeah. Whatever.
I would say gaining weight was harder for me than losing, honestly.
Really?
Yeah, I always had more trouble like eating the right things and eating more than
I agree with you.
I had so much.
Because when I was like very lean at the time in CrossFit, eating broccoli like six times a day and like just like like I was doing everything right, but at that point it became kind of hard to eat.
Right.
Hard to eat all the protein, hit the targets and macros. And the last question I have is like, if you could do only one exercise for the rest of your life, what would it be?
One exercise for the rest of my life? Because I enjoy it, or it's like the best exercise?
It's the best exercise. It could be a stretch exercise. It could be a body lift exercise.
That's a tough question.
You know?
Probably still have to go with squats again. I mean, that's just squats the basic again? And fundamental.
I don't feel like, I feel like, you know, like that question was like a repeat of like earlier.
Fair enough.
But I guess, thanks ChatGPT, I guess.
Yeah.
Awesome. But yeah, man, I mean, it was great having you.
Appreciate
Do you have any questions for me that, you know, you felt like I should have asked or anything?
Nothing at all. I mean, where are you at right now for your fitness journey?
Oh, I'm, man, I started deadlifting during your Candido workout.
Nice.
I'm still on it now, but I got a little injured and I came back. And I'm going back with, you know, great recovery, great spine mobility, great hip mobility.
Amazing.
So hopefully the goal is, you know, by the end of like January, I probably beat my previous PR.
Yeah, there you go.
So I'm still doing it. I'm on like week like fourth time cycling. Mm-hmm. So I've been doing it. I just burn less weights. But I like it so far, and I'm also running every single day.
Man.
I'm doing like a challenge on my podcast where I'm running every day. But at one point, I just stopped posting because I'm like, this is too much.
It's hard.
For 100 days is just like not possible.
For sure.
You know?
Glad to hear it, though. Glad it's moving in the right direction.
Yeah, man. But yeah, we'll definitely come back on. And, you know, for those watching, Kishan, plug your Instagram in if you have one, if they want to follow you.
I think it's KI.Patel23. I don't use Instagram much, so I'd have to double check, but yeah.
Okay. Well, where can they find you if they want to book a
call? Usually just Instagram. It's the Instagram itself is public, so if anyone wants to message me there, or if they could just message you too and then find you through me, that's fine too.
Okay, great. Awesome. So thanks so much, brother.
Appreciate it.
Appreciate you. Thanks. Thanks for coming on.
You got it.